through a gentleman named Wayne Klingman, who came from like Michigan Film Festival. And we had a short film called The Dark and Lonely Knife that we submitted to Deadpit. And I had never heard of them. And Wayne said, hey, you know, these guys are going to review your film this episode, you know, go here and listen to them. And I listened to them, and I've told these guys, I admit, the first time, I couldn't stop laughing the first time I heard their accents. I was like, oh my God, what's going on here, you know? But, you know, they gave us a good review, and we liked it, and we just kind of, I don't know, we exchanged emails or something, and it was like, you know, there were really cool guys who emails, and I sent them a couple DVDs to give away or something. Then the next film we had came out, and they reviewed that and gave us a good review, and I started listening to their show, and Wes was joking around one day, and he said on the show that, you know, someone ought to do a documentary about us or something.
I think I had a fan question.
Or something like that.
I told you, like, right off the bat, I was like, why the hell do they want to do a documentary on us?
Jim here and I, who's the producer with Rusty Robot, we thought, yeah, that would be kind of cool, those guys, you know. And I didn't know anything about Deadpit at the time, just from listening to him. So we came up with a whole storyline. We convinced this guy to give us money because we really thought they were movers and shakers in like the independent Hollywood scene. So I convinced this guy to give us money to go down to Prestonsburg, you know, and we met him, and you know, we're like, okay, this is cool, you know, these are really nice guys and it's really interesting. And I mean, I hate to say it, but it was such a totally different culture and area from where we were from. I'm from Detroit, Jim's from Milwaukee. And the fact that these guys are really something special in their town. I mean, they really are. I mean, they're doing this. Well, I mean, you know, I mean, we tried to get that across in the film that, you know, I mean, it was really hard because a lot of people wouldn't let us shoot. But they really kind of stick out in the town as far as what they're doing, you know. And I mean, this is a town that's really into, you know, it's coal mining and it's country music and it's wrestling and bluegrass music and stuff like that. And these guys are doing a horror podcast. And when we talked to the one Jeff, and when we talked to the one guy, Fred James, he was just like, well, I don't believe people like that are doing that around here, you know, because he didn't know about it.
So, why didn't you put that in the documentary?
Well, yeah. We tried to limit his screen time because none of us like him, so.
I think the interesting thing about Prestonsburg, though, that a lot of people don't realize is I think there's a lot of closet horror fans in that area.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
And it's just one of those things you don't really talk about. I think you found that out more after we first filmed.
And that's kind of how James got into the movies, because we were talking to Freddie, and he goes, oh, there's a horror fan who's been around for years, this James guy.
Yeah, it's like,
we're like, oh, and they didn't know who he was.
That's like us in like 20 years.
He looks like one of my neighbors.
I have an honest, serious question.
Sure.
Not about your mom.
Okay.
Honestly, outside of the documentary, the popularity Yoons are having, do Yoons feel the need to keep interviewing or try to get interviews with people like Carpenter and Romero, since you got people like Fango Radio that nobody gives a blue fuck about, because D. Snyder just wants to talk about Strangeland? And do Yoons feel that Yoons are actually the voice of a real horror fan that's out there? It doesn't give a shit that Rob Zombie's remaking Halloween.
I think we are like kind of channeling that group of people that really like the 70s and 80s stuff and that really dig, like really dig horror films and films in general, and not just like, you know, teeny bopper people that kind of get into it for a little while and go and see Saw and Hostel and, you know, go. It's like a fad for a lot of people, but I mean, I think to some degree, yeah. I mean, and we try to provide some alternative. You don't have to listen to shit, but we don't want Fangoria just to be the only game in town. Like Fangoria, Rue Morgue, maybe a couple others that I'm not too familiar with.
Old Crotchy's Radio Hour?
Yeah, Old Crotchy's Radio.
That's a good one.
Yeah, somebody's got to be trying to find some of these people, like, you know, the Linnea Quigleys and the people that don't get the respect and stuff that they deserve, the James Bryans, the people that make these films and nobody fucking...
But I've noticed, though, that the more we do the show, a lot of times the shows we have with no interviews are more popular than the ones with.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, right.
But so it's like, I mean, it really, there's really no
honestly,
point.
Honestly, the John Carpenter interview is the best one you've ever done. It is the best show, the best interview, because I don't think any article, any magazine I've ever read has gotten a better interview out of John Carpenter.
I guess we did have a good day.
I think we did, when we talked to him about wrestling, he was like, what the hell? Where'd that come from?
He's a big wrestling fan. He is a huge wrestling fan.
Yeah. I also wrote this question. What is your guys' secret about going out and actually getting the contact info to contact these artists and celebrities and stuff?
What is our...
How do you guys go out and do it? How do you get them?
Well, a subject that wasn't really covered too much in the documentary was the site we had before Deadpit, which focused more on collecting autographs, get the contact info that way. We had a huge notepad list full of contacts that we used early on. I mean, we started, I guess, with Friday the 13th interviews, and then we realized, shit, people